So our next speaker is Dr. Tania Jain. She'll be speaking on role of international fellowships.
Hello and good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Tania. I'm a first-hand uveitis person working in Dr. Shroff's Charity Eye Hospital in New Delhi. And you might be wondering, why am I talking about an international fellowship? That is because I had the opportunity to work at Stanford University in California, USA. So these are some pictures from there. It is one, we all know that it is one of the biggest and the center of innovation. It is at the hub of the startup universe. It's at the Silicon Valley, right where Facebook, Apple, etc. So I went there for a uveitis fellowship, and this is me at the Stanford campus, and you can see the beautiful campus with the palm trees in California. And I went to work under Dr. Kwan. He is a world-renowned uveitis specialist who is also one of the founders of AAO and AAO case reports. So I worked with him. And I'm here to talk about how did I get here and how did I decide to pursue this in my career. So I'll be talking mainly about these things. So first is, why should one do an international fellowship? Then second is, how to find a niche, how to approach the mentor on the institute that you want to go in. Is there actually any role of doing ICO or FRCS? How to get a scholarship, because you know that California is maybe one of the most expensive places in USA also. What to expect when you get there and what to expect when you get back. So broadly, either you go there to learn and come back and work in your country, or you go there to settle and work there. So if you want to go there to settle, then that is a completely different talk. So today I'll be talking about how we learn there and come back. So first is, why do we want to go there? Everybody can have their different reasons. So these are few of the reasons that I came across. One would be like to know the latest medical trends, what's going on in the Western world. Second could be to learn from an expert, to get exposure, to get a degree or diploma, to maybe amp up your CV, to get into some clinical trials. Then I met a lot of people from Korea actually who had come there because they wanted their kids to speak good English. So that is also one of the things. To get into hardcore research at, you know, molecular level. And that could also actually be a path for you to settling down there. And well, there could be some who would just like to go there to travel. So for me, it was mainly to learn from an expert and to get the exposure of what was happening right there, you know. But what I would say is, how did I go into uveitis and how did I think? One should always ask and self-actualize that, what do we want to actually do in life and what really interests us and motivates us, that when we wake up every day, we don't feel like, you know, we're going to work. We feel like, you know, wow, we're going to work and, you know, we're excited about it. So it is very, very important to find a niche that you want to work in. That would really solve like 99% of your problems. So like, I knew that I wanted to be, I wanted to pursue uveitis. So I knew that there were few uveitis specialists who are doing, you know, cutting edge work, and I approached them. So for someone who's, you know, doing retina, they know that, you know, they're very much interested in uveitis, in maybe ROP, or maybe someone who's doing plasties, very interested, in oncology. So you know, which institutes are good and which mentors to approach. So how I did it was that I, honestly, you will not believe it, I just wrote an email. I didn't do anything else. And I told him that I'm interested. I sent him my CV, and he conducted an interview with me on Zoom, and he called me over with a J-1 visa. So even though I had done ICO while I was doing my residency, there are definitely certain pros with it, but when I applied for the ICO thing, they never really replied back to me. And it's a very slow process and very inconsistent replies. So I did definitely need a scholarship. There were a lot of options available actually right now. But what really worked out for me was IOFF. So IOFF is International Ophthalmology Foundation Fund. It is basically a European organization. They offer three types of fellowships. One is a three-month one where you get like around $6,000, which supports your travel and living expenses. Then one is a year-long one where you get around $24,000 or $30,000. And another one is another one-year one, but these are at very few institutes. So you can go to their website and see they offer a wide variety of institutes, like including Stanford, Carol Shields, and you know, so you can actually search for your area of interest and just go and apply. So they see your CV and then they tell you that fine, we've accepted you, and then you can go and actually look for a host institute and apply there. So this is like the network of the fellowship institutes that you can see. And you can just mail, even if you have any doubt, you can just mail at this email ID, cgo@IOFF. So this person is Cordula. I met her when at San Francisco during AAO. She's a very nice, warm person. And this is definitely one of the paths that you could take. Then what to expect when you get there? Accommodation, you know, you can ask, we all have relatives or there are websites. Would suggest to be nearby to your hospital, because driving there is definitely one thing that everybody needs. I mean, a driver's license is not accepted in every country, and the public transport is really, really bad there. So it's good if it's nearby, walking or cycling. And food, I think it's a globalized world. I absolutely had no problem with food. So academically, my days were divided into clinics, research, and clinical trials. So they had 2 or 3 days of clinics where you could go and see the patients. So most of the fellowships, at least in USA, I know are non-surgical ones. But there are other countries, some fellowships like in Canada and UK, they do offer surgical ones also. But, you know, we would just sit in the clinic. We would be assigned patients. We would see the patients, talk to them, write everything, and then present it to the professor. Then research, there was definitely lots and lots of research. And they even had symposiums where people, they were doing all kinds of work with AI. And, like, a very, very interesting thing that I came across was that they were printing 3D glasses for patients with facial dysmorphism. Like, they could not have normal glasses on them, so they were printing some 3D glasses which were customized to their face. And also, the most important thing and the thing that I would cherish is meeting people from all across the world. So you can see here, so Dr. Kuan had a large team where he had fellows like me, but there were fellows from all over the world. There was one from Egypt, from Singapore, from Canada, from Nepal, and Iran, Philippines. So I met people from ophthalmologists. They were all trained retina or cataract surgeons who were interested in uveitis. So there was a lot of exchange of ideas, and so that was something that really, really interested me. So this is us working at the clinic. Then one thing that I did not personally have an exposure here was how do actually clinical trials work. So this person was involved in very, very big clinical trials like VIEW, VISTA and all. And now I had the opportunity of working in trials like Leopard, Neptune. And so if you actually hear about these trials someday, and they are all, you know, in process, recruiting patients, I was basically involved in different steps in different trials. In some trials, I was seeing the patients. In some, I was writing the protocol. In some, I was, you know, writing the manuscript. So I had an exposure of working with different trials. And this is one of my patients who was given ACTH hormone for his scleritis. So this is actually a $26,000 drug or something which they're giving in trials with very, very good results, by the way. But what to expect? When you come back, definitely there are limitations. Mainly because for them, everything is paid by insurance, and our patients, they even, like, even for FFA, you have to think twice, actually. But if you have the passion and if you actually convince the patient that you know what you're talking about, you can convince them. And there are so I have the pleasure of working with Dr. Sangwan at Shroff's Hospital, and he actually made me connect with certain NGOs who are willing to pay for the immunological for the biologic drugs, which are very expensive for patients to pay otherwise. So you can definitely find a way. That thing is, you have to take that step first and, you know, go out there and get to know what else can you do for your patient. So it changed a lot of things for me, but that's all. I think I've exceeded my time. So any questions, you can just email me or contact me. Thank you. No. So this was not because I had the ICU degree. Yeah, it didn't matter. He just like asked me general questions like, what do you do? What kind of surgeries do you do? Why are you interested in uveitis and stuff like that? Like nothing very hi-fi. Yeah. No, I had completed my retina fellowship and I was working as a consultant, and I took, so this was for 6 months, so I took like a sabbatical and I went there, yeah. Thank
you. Doesn't look like a sabbatical, I guess.
So people who come here, you can come for the, you can get your presentation ready. Meanwhile,
sir, milte hain wahan pe aloo parathe.
नहीं
फ्रेश सर. सो क्या जो सिलिकॉन वैली है वहाँ पे सारा टेक हब है, सो वहाँ पे सबसे ज़्यादा इंडियंस है सर. हाँ नो नो यू गेट एवरीथिंग. या This IOFF is actually funded by I Foundation. Yeah. So that's what you just have to ask. Those people are so approachable, you would not believe it. Like, just ask.
So,
whatever you're interested in.
Well, this is a lot of opportunities are there.
Yeah.
And